something I'm going to be reading to you this morning.
Maybe I will.
From the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 17 through 26. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through the prophets, saying that the Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out and the times of refreshing may come from the Lord. And that he may send a Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything, as he promised long ago through the holy prophets. For Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up a prophet like me from among you people, your own people, who must listen to everything. You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen will be cut off from his people." Indeed, the beginning with Samuel, all the prophets who had spoken had foretold of these days. And you, the heirs of the prophets, and of the covenant of God, that God made with your fathers. He said, "Abraham, though your offspring, all peoples on the earth will be blessed. When God raised up his servant, he sent him to bless you and to turn each of you from your wicked ways." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, you're here long enough, they take your tie, they take your pulpit, they take your hat. It's good to see you all. Putting this service together has been very meaningful to us, and we hope that it continues to be meaningful to you. We have, of course, baptism this morning. We praise God for that. We have our children. What a blessing to just have so many children here this past week to get to know and to teach and to just have fun with, and you can see just the joy on their faces. What a blessing it is to be a church that values our children. And of course, we had a wonderful presentation by Bob Dees. Now, truth be told, we had so many movements in the service, exciting to me, that I thought, well, maybe, you know, I won't have that much time to preach. You know, everyone has Father's Day plans. But we're right on time, which is really good. So for the next 45 minutes, I'm going to invite you to... Oh, I heard a boo. Now, there are a lot of visitors in the house. Trust me, 45 minutes for me would be two sermons, so people are laughing for a reason. But I do ask that you turn your Bible to Acts chapter 3. Just keep your finger there so that you can refer to a few things as we try to figure out what this lesson might mean for us today. Some challenges that God might give us through this week as we walk this week and work and be with our family. There's always something that God wants us to be mindful of. Things that we can write down if you're writing notes. I invite you to do that as well. You'll remember that the last few weeks, we've been talking about restoration. And I mentioned last week that if you use a word too much, it starts to lose its meaning. So in order to keep it meaningful, we pointed out that Acts really paints us a picture of what it means that God is a God of restoration. That when the Holy Spirit came, the Holy Spirit brought about reformation in so many ways. We talked for about 2 weeks ago how the Holy Spirit filled Christ's church and restored the community of God's people to be God's people, to be that light in order to share the good news of Christ, the risen Savior who comes to save the sins of the world. And if you read through Acts chapter 1 and 2, we see the restoration of the community in so many ways, even to the point where there's economic restoration. An idea that Christ's community is a generous, hospitable community. They share things in common. They share a common meal and the lessons of the church. And they also are dedicated to prayer. And now, in Acts chapter 3, we'll see that there's restoration of our physical well-being, our spiritual well-being, in building up community by being people who are whole, who follow a God who is complete and whole as three in one. You remember that? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, I got to thinking this past week, actually came, I don't know how I got the idea, somebody gave it to us, maybe it was Christina. Was it your idea? The kids bought fidget spinners. Now, there are a lot of children in the house. How many of you have fidget spinners? Okay? There's a few of you. Now, if you don't have a fidget spinner, don't worry, because people for thousands of years have gotten by without fidget spinners, okay? So, if you don't have one. But if you do, most fidget spinners have the three sides, right? So you spin it, and you have the three. Well, if you're in school, I encourage you to show people your fidget spinner and say, you know what? I follow a God who's three in one. God the Father, God the Spirit, and God the Son. And when you spin the fidget spinner, it makes God who is one, right? All right, so there you go. So that's what you can do for the fidget spinner. In Acts chapter 3, we see restoration coming about in our well-being. We come upon a man who's been born lame, and Scripture is very specific on how it describes and sets up the scene, because Luke, the author of Acts, wants you to move along and walk with this person and try to figure out what kind of restoration the Holy Spirit is going to bring to this man who had been born lame and who every day had to get somebody to carry him to the gates. It shows a complete dependence that this person had on other people, not only dependence on mobility to get to the gate, but also a dependence in begging. And when we look at this passage, we get the sense that he's left out. He's at the gate with absolutely helpless, outside of the help of people who might otherwise give him a hand. And we have to know that he's helpless in more than one way. Not only is he lame, but according to the Old Testament law, he is not able to be included in worship with the rest of the people. You see, as a person with a disability, he could not be allowed to enter into that gate to worship with the temple. So his whole life is one in which he stared to the ground and simply held out a hand and depended on others. That is until the disciples came by at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, sometime around there, a time for prayer. And as Peter and the rest of them looked upon this man, they saw an opportunity, not a disability, but an opportunity for God's power to work. The man asked for money, and the disciples, being poor Galileans, said, "We don't have money, but I will give you what I do have." Isn't that amazing? Peter is confident of what God has given him, of what he has for this gentleman. And we see a movement here of restoration in so many little clues in the biblical text. You almost have to get your magnifying glass to see what kind of clues are in this text. First, they ask that the man meet their eyes. Looking a person into his eyes. Now, this is a small detail, but you have to see that through the whole life. He wouldn't look at people. He would stare down in his infirmity and put out his hand and beg for money. And the disciples say, look us in the eyes. We represent something different. Peter then reaches out and holds his hand. And in this miracle, brings him up. Scripture tells us that his ankles were strengthened, and he is so filled with joy, so empowered by the Spirit, that he doesn't just stand up. What does he do? He leaps, and he jumps, and he makes his way, leaping and jumping, as joyful as the children, into the temple for the first time in his life, in order to join his brothers and sisters as the people of God and be united in that place of worship. So restoration moves in a sort of movement in this text. We move from being lame to leaping, and from going to the gate of being excluded to being included in temple worship. Now, people were bewildered. Scripture tells us more than once that the crowds were amazed that this miracle happened. And I got to think, bewilderment is something that carries on throughout the book of Acts. And I always wonder, at what point did the church give up on the bewilderment business? Why is it that we have not been a community that continues to surprise and bring awe and bewilderment to the world to the point where it attracts people to want to know this person, Jesus, who's risen from the dead and has saved us? Well, that's a question we need to answer a different day. We do have Father's Day plans after all, but it's something to keep in mind. It's this bewilderment that attracts the crowds, and Peter gives his third sermon, And through that sermon lays out a few themes that I want to hit on very briefly here today. There are about four or five themes in Peter's sermon, but there are about three that I really want to hit on. First, if you read into the scripture text around verse 12, which is, we skipped that part for the sake of brevity, you'll note that as people were bewildered, one of the themes of Peter's sermon is that the same power who rose Jesus from the dead is the same power that fills the man and brought him to a place of restoration and wholeness. That it wasn't some voodoo or some magic that happened, but rather a power stemming right from God the Father, who provides, and God the Son, who gives power and empowers us. Now, if you move along around verse 13, 12 or 13, the next verse, verse 13, you'll notice that as Peter is preaching, he states that it is the same God of our fathers, of our ancestors, some translations say, the same God of Abraham and Moses and all of the prophets is the same God who is doing a new work through those who believe in the risen Lord, a new work in Christ's community. Oh, time, if you go to verses later, in verses 19, 20, 21, a time of refreshing, that gives us a glimpse of the kind of ultimate restoration, verse 21, that God is going to bring about when Jesus comes back to reclaim earth as his own. So we have the same power that rose Christ from the dead that is giving life and well-being and health and wellness to this individual, this lame man. It is the same God of our ancestors who is working a new work through the church, through the disciples. And if you read to the very end of Peter's sermon, it is the same blessing with which God is blessing the church and the people of God, and the blessing that is moving beyond, the very same blessing that God gave Abraham way back in the earliest pages of Genesis. You see, when God called Abraham to be a father of many nations, when God called Abraham out of Ur and established a people for himself, he said that part of the DNA of being that church, part of the call was to be a blessing to all people, that all people will come to know God through that blessing. And they tended to keep it to themselves. They failed to share it. So there's the same power, the same God of our ancestors, and the same blessing. Now, when you read through this text and you understand kind of the thematic subjects here that Peter is really laying out, he is pushing back against what I think are myths. Now, many of us heard of fake news, right? It's a big thing of the day. Well, back then they had fake news. And for many cases, we still have fake news infiltrating our church even today. When you read all of Peter's sermon and you pick out these themes, it's as if he's pushing back on myths, or at least the author of Luke is in this entire story. The first is, and if you take notes, you may want to write this down, think about it, the myth of self-sufficiency. The myth of self-sufficiency. See, we are people who think we can do things by ourselves, that we have the power to do the things that we want to get done, that we have the power and authority in and of ourselves, apart from everyone else, in order to get our way, in order to bring about the kind of transformation that we long for. But this story, starting with verse 1, is built upon this principle of dependence. Notice, the man who's lame is dependent and becomes empowered by the Spirit enough to leap to his feet and get to the temple. But then as you move on into those later verses, you find that Peter confronts the people about power and authority. He says, do you think that I yield this man out of my own power? Do you think that the power I wield is sufficient enough? Me, myself, and I, a Galilean fisherman, is powerful enough to heal a man, to bring a miracle? No, it is not. We depend on the power of God to bring restoration and wellness in order to bring people to the very lordship of Christ. So there's a bit of an undercurrent of dependence. The man is dependent, now he's empowered to worship. Peter seems empowered. He has the ability and the mobility and the well-being to go into the temple, but he is not dependent on himself. Rather, he is dependent on the very power of God that flows into him and through the disciples and those who follow Christ. So this disrupts and confronts the myth of self-sufficiency. We do not have the power to do what we want, but Christ gives those of us who call him Lord power to do what God wants us to do. Now, another myth that Peter confronts here is the myth of what I call the cult of the individual. You know, we're pretty individualistic as a society. I do what I want, you do what you want. In fact, I can do whatever I want. Don't tell me what to do, right? It's the power of the individual. And too often, our churches, much less society, is infected with such an individualism that we even think we can go it alone. Some of us think that we can just grow in Christ by ourselves. In fact, I have known many people who say, I don't go to church, don't need church. I can meet God in my backyard. Now, part of that is true. But I can tell you right now, the people who said, I don't need church, are some of the people who have the worst Facebook posts I've ever read. I can guarantee you. You see, you're right. You can meet God in your backyard. You can meet God on your patio. You can meet God on the beach. But this text shows us the power of community as this person is welcomed into community for the first time ever. That part of the healing process, part of being whole, is being united and in communion with the body of Christ, Christ's church, where the power and authority of Christ, the risen Lord, resides. So this disrupts the myth of self-sufficiency. This disrupts the myth of the cult of the individual. And lastly, I think that this text, and this brings us to our Father's Day theme, I think, shows us that Peter was battling against the myth of a God who is not real. Now, what do I mean by that? Have you ever heard somebody say, well, God of the Old Testament is different than the God of the New Testament? You ever hear people say that? God in the Old Testament is a God of wrath and of judgment and of condemnation, but God in the New Testament, well, that's the God of love and compassion and grace. Many of you have heard that, right? We find here a community that has made God in their own image to the point where they forgot their values. They forgot that they are called to be a blessing to others. They forgot that they are called to bring about the miracles and power of God, that the same God of their ancestors, the same God who split and parted the sea, the same God who brought plagues upon Egypt, is the same God that can bring healing to their land, if only they understood and remembered who God is. You see, God that you meet in the Old Testament is the same God that you meet in the New Testament. God is a God of love and of grace and compassion from Genesis all the way to Revelation. You see, if we see God differently in the Old Testament, that's not God's problem. That's our problem. Because we find in the Old Testament that there was such disobedience within the people of God. They tried to do their own thing, trying to be self-sufficient, trying to go their own way, that God had to bring discipline, which is still very much a part of God's community. That God is still a God who cares so much about his children that he is willing to do whatever it takes to love them. So what we see here is Peter is saying, look, this God who rose this man from being disabled, it's not a different movement. It's not a new movement. It's not something different. This is the very same God who gave us our founding mission when God told Abraham that we are to be a blessing to all the nations. Now, you have to kind of look close at this, at the connection that Peter is making. You'll notice, I believe it's in verse 19 or 20. The reason why I say that is because in different translations, it's in one verse or the other. But if you read verses 19 and 20, it says that Peter is living into, with the disciples in Christ's church, a season of refreshing. So a fresh spirit or a fresh kind of movement. That Greek word for fresh is only used one other time in the Bible. And when you go to the Old Testament, you have to go to the Greek Old Testament, which Luke, who wrote the book of Acts, would use the Greek Old Testament. And the only other place where that word for refreshing is used in a time when God brought the plagues upon Egypt. It said that the pestilence came and all the plagues came, and there's a moment within that Exodus story where it says that God gave the people time to refresh, a time of rest. And the only and that word is used in that time, and that's the only other time the Bible is used. So there's a clear connection that Peter is saying, look, that God of the Old Testament, that you it's fake news. It's made up. That's not the real impression of God. The same God who created the universe is the same God who loves and cares and wants us to be blessed. That same very same God that we find working through Christ Jesus, whom God rose from the dead. That's basically the point of Peter. You see, for the people at that time, they thought that blessing, the blessing that they inherited, that covenant of blessing, that it was a luxury. Peter was reminding them that their blessing is not a luxury. It's a missional imperative, something to share with those who still may need strengthening of the ankles, who still may need a good word of hope, who are down and out, and need somebody to look them in the eye and say, brother, I care about you, and God wants to heal your life. Still the same God with the same blessing, who has the blessing that gives us courage to hold somebody's hand and say, come, come to the temple. We want to include you. We want to give you a place to belong in God's family. We want to share with you the love of Christ. Still, the kind of blessing in which we recognize that we are not dependent on ourselves. We can have all the money in the world. It doesn't make us sufficient. Rather, we follow with Peter, who says, I'm going to give you one thing I know I have. Where though that thing where moth and rust cannot destroy, and that is the love and compassion and power of God, whom God gives us when God breathes in us the Holy Spirit to be the very church of Christ. So, as Peter is combating these myths, it is still relevant for us today. We are to experience the same power who brings to life and allows those who are lame to leap. We still worship the same God who is the same God all the way back to Genesis, who can work miracles and wonders to the point where we can still surprise the world and bring them to Christ. And we still work off of the very same blessing that we are called to share, not keep to ourselves, but share in order to bring restoration and to point to the healing power of God, our Father. Amen? Amen. Amen.